Good evening, everyone. On behalf of the Brewers of the Sake Export Association, and of course myself, I'd like to thank everybody for being here tonight. As Mr. Sakurai pointed out, this is the 17th year that this program has been taking place. Sake continues to grow, more and more of it is being exported every year, and it continues to grow in popularity. And without a doubt, New York is one of the places where it's growing the fastest and showing the most steady growth. And so we'd like to thank you all for your continued support of sake, as well as this program. Very quickly, just to explain the flow of the evening, I'll talk for probably about a half an hour on tonight's topic, which, as Mr. Sakurai pointed out, is sake and food. And then we will introduce the brewers, the 11 brewers that are here tonight, after which they'll step back and prepare for the coming onslaught of people to come and taste the 32 sake across them. After that point in time, though, we'll remain here and I'll answer some questions, any Q&A questions that you might have before we all break and go to the tasting after. That's how things will flow. Across the 17 years that we've been giving this program here, I've covered a lot of topics. I've covered a lot of technical topics. I've covered cultural things. I've covered historical things. Most of them were more focused on sake production, the various grades, the raw materials, things like that. But not once have I ever spoken about sake and food, as important as that topic is and as interesting as it is to many people, I'm sure. It wasn't a deliberate omission. I definitely didn't avoid that topic. It just seemed to me that over the years there were things that seemed to me to be more important to talk about, to make sake more accessible and approachable to everybody. That's been pretty much my goal up until now, but the time has come to address sake and food, I think. Certainly, it's something I've become quite interested myself in it, so I think the timing is right for that. So to begin with, talking about sake and food, the first and probably most important thing to convey is that it's not rocket science. It's not that difficult. If you know how to pair wine and food, or the principles of pairing other alcoholic beverages and food, then you know how to pair sake and food. We'll talk more about what those principles are. But it certainly doesn't need to be anything that's intimidating. It's basically fairly simple and not rocket science at all. The principles and the thinking between pairing sake and food and pairing wine and food will pretty much be the same. The next thing to point out is that there's no big rules as there are in the wine world. There's no rules like red with meat and wine with fish. I think this is extremely useful. I think 90% of the people can go very far with a very simple generalization like this. But unfortunately, there isn't any such big generalization in the sake world for a number of reasons. There's no big rules or generalizations like this. There are many theories out there, and this is something I think that's important to convey. There's a lot of theories about pairing sake and food out there, but there's no one way. There's no one commonly accepted way in Japan. There's no one official way. There's no one traditional way to do it. There's no one totally accepted way. So there's no proper way to violate. That's what I'm trying to say. There are a number of theories out there. Some people that you should pair based on the umami in the food, and the umami in the sake. We'll talk about umami again in a little while. Others say look at the acidity or the intensity or the weight. I've actually heard one person say that you should pair sake and food based on the yin and yang of the sake and the food, which I didn't quite get. And yet someone else talked about pairing sake based upon the seasons. So there's millions of theories out there. But the more important thing to convey is there really isn't one officially accepted or even widely accepted way of pairing, which really frees us up to do anything that we would like to do. You can still do a lot of things. You can pair based on acidity. You can pair based on umami, which we'll talk about. Intensity, things like that. There's plenty that you can do, but there's no absolute one authentic way to do that. Sake is indeed extremely versatile. It goes with a hugely wide range of food. There's expressions in Japanese that amount to that sake doesn't pick fights with food, or that sake doesn't get in the way of food. And it really does pair with a very wide range of food. Now, initially, I used to think that this sounded like a cop-out. In other words, for hundreds of years, nobody ever really thought about it. And so when you started to ask them, they said, well, it goes with everything. When in fact, the more time I spend with sake, the more that I realize that it really does have a lot of potential, extremely versatile and very food friendly. In fact, it rarely picks a fight with anything else on the table. There is a lot to work with when we're pairing sake, and we talk more about that in a little while, but even though we say it goes with a very wide range of food, that doesn't mean that there aren't any mismatches at all. Certainly there are some mismatches. I mean, extremely spicy things are going to overpower a sake. Very, very powerful flavors are going to as well. I think if you were to have a mismatch with wine and food, then one or the other or both would really taste very bad. But I don't think really sake lends itself to that. In other words, when you do have a mismatch with sake, what happens is the sake tends to be overwhelmed and just kind of be insignificant, almost as if it wasn't on the table. You can really overpower a sake that way if you're not careful. So there are some mismatches, but what happens is the sake just ends up being a less significant factor on the table when that happens. Having said that, really strong or spicy things like this, just an example, a very rich nigori sake. I don't know if you drink much nigori compared to clear sake, but that could actually cool something like this down. So even though I say it can be overpowered by spicy things like that, there are exceptions to even that rule as well. Why are the reasons, some of the technical reasons that sake is food friendly? There actually are a few technical reasons behind why this is. To me, the real reason it's so food friendly, the real reason it never picks fights with food or gets in the way, is because there's nothing overly ostentatious about it. You don't have any really strong, overpowering aspects of sake that would get in the way. If we were to look at wine again, which is, I think, the easiest thing to compare it to, tannins in pairing wine and food are a really important part of that. However, if the tannins, if there's too much tannin in the wine, then it just puts it right out of the competition. Sake has zero tannins at all, so you're never going to come across that problem. It's just out of the competition. Another one is acidity. Sake tends to have about a tenth to about a fifth of the acidity of white wine. However, you can use acidity in pairing with sake because it's all a relative thing. One sake compared to another would certainly have more or less acidity, and it would be a noticeable thing. But you're never going to have a massive amount of acidity in the wine, and so you're never going to get a problem based on too much acidity in pairing with something else. So there's just certain things that a wine doesn't have, that a sake doesn't have, that save it from a lot of clashes and therefore make it extremely food-friendly and hard to find total mismatch. When we look at how sake and food are paired, I think it's worthwhile to look at how it all got started. And again, I think that sake and food pairing got started the same way that wine and food pairing got started. In other words, sake flavor profiles developed in the various regions of Japan based on what kind of food was being eaten there, based on the traditional cuisine of the various regions. If we were to look at Japan, we can see that it's a very long country north to south. And along the middle of most of the country, you've got some very, very high mountains. So you've got a lot of mountainous regions, and then just beyond the mountainous regions, you've got a lot of flat plains with roads and infrastructure that allow things to move more quickly. And then beyond that, of course, you've got a lot of shoreline. And the kind of food that was being eaten in these various regions, of course, varied quite a bit. For example, long ago up in the mountains, they weren't getting fresh sashimi on a daily basis. They were eating pickled, preserved foods with very strong flavors, very commonly very salty flavors were commonly eaten up in the mountains just because things didn't move very quickly and they ate a lot of preserved food. The sake that developed in those regions would be something that went along with that, richer, heavier sake. Very often sake was much sweeter than in the other regions. These days in the mountains, they are getting fresh sashimi on a daily basis if they want it with a quick drive to the convenience store. But long ago when sake profiles developed, that wasn't the case. When you move down from the mountains, you've got lots of flat plains and a lot of rice is grown down there, but you've also got a lot of roads, and that infrastructure allows raw materials to move much more quickly. So the fruit and the vegetables and the meat and the fish that people were eating could be kept fresh. You didn't have to preserve that because there was fresh stuff coming in all the time. So the styles of sake that developed in these plain regions where raw materials are moving much quickly is much lighter and more delicate than some of the heavier stuff in the mountains. Furthermore, when you go to the shoreline, especially near prefectures and areas with large fishing ports, you had fresh fish coming in on a daily basis. I mean, almost everybody was enjoying a lot of fresh fish long ago, at least in the cities near big fishing ports. And so the sake that developed around there was much more supple and delicate than sake in the other regions. So the type of sake that is enjoyed in each part of Japan developed according to the traditional cuisine that people were eating, and that developed based on the kind of the lay of the land over there. If we look at the truth about sake and food pairing in Japan, I think this is another significant point. Sake and food pairing traditionally and historically, has not been nearly as an active a practice as wine and food pairing has been in the West. I think that if any of us went to Paris 100 years ago and into a good restaurant there, they would have a wine list, a list of wine in Paris even 100 years ago. Even today, if you go to a good restaurant, a traditional restaurant in Japan that serves a particular kind of cuisine, you'll find maybe one or two sake, especially the older places that focus on one particular kind of cuisine. You'll maybe find one or two sake. And the whole thinking is we want you to focus on the food, and naturally good sake will support good Japanese food. So enjoy the food, enjoy the setting, enjoy the presentation, we'll take care of the sake. And that thinking, it's changing. Certainly a lot of restaurants are carrying a lot more sake than they used to in Tokyo as well. But I think even today you can go into some really wonderful restaurants and find one or two sake. One ear marked for warm and one ear marked for cold. I recall going into a sushi shop that I used to frequent in Tokyo. And I would frequent it enough where I could tease the guy behind the counter. And I one time hassled him about only having one sake. And he came back at me and he said, listen, I was up at 5 a.m. going down at Tsukiji, the fish market, to get 20 different kinds of fish. He says, do you think I want you focusing on the sake? Concentrate on the fish. I'll take care of the sake, and trust me, it'll be good. And I think that is a lot of the thinking as to why a lot of restaurants in Japan, even today, don't have as huge a sake list as you might expect. That is improving, though. That is changing quite a bit. So really, if we look at the truth of how they do it in Japan, the truth is they don't, at least not traditionally. More fairly put, sake and food pairing is not nearly, traditionally, historically anyway, as active a process as it has been with wine and food overseas. If you want to, having said that, even though it hasn't been as active a process, precise pairings are perfectly possible. It is really very possible to do very precise pairings. I mean, every course of a multi-course meal can very easily be paired with a sake that really brings out the most of that. So it's perfectly possible to do this kind of a thing. You can be really precise with the pairings for sure. And that's happening more and more. Maybe not in old traditional stuffy restaurants, but in modern restaurants that serve a lot of sake, you're starting to see a lot more active, precise pairing taking place with sake and modern food. So it's really moving in a very good direction. In terms of what does go well with sake, obviously Japanese food in almost all of its manifestations is a great pairing for sake. I mean, just about everything that is considered part of the realm of Japanese food will go very well with sake. Sake is not going to get in the way of it. It's going to support Japanese food, and that's a really easy way to get into it. However, if we were to limit ourselves to Japanese food or washoku, we'd really be limiting sake very much. Its potential to grow towards world domination would be highly limited if we were to limit it to Japanese food. I mean, there's countless great Japanese restaurants here in New York, but there's even more non-Japanese restaurants. And if we were to just try and say, okay, the only time you need to drink sake is when you're having Japanese food, we would really limit the potential of sake as well as its growth as a premium beverage. So as much as it does go very well with Japanese food, we need to kind of move beyond that. Speaking of washoku or Japanese food, many of you may know, and I just want to congratulate Japan, I guess, and Japanese food in general, washoku has been added to UNESCO's intangible cultural heritage list, which is really a very good thing. And the government in Japan is doing a lot to actively promote this and make the most of it. And I really want to encourage them in doing that, because I think it is a wonderful thing that it's got worldwide recognition now. I think that there are many different types of Japanese food. I mean, it's not all sushi, as everybody knows. But I think the one thread of consistency that runs through all of Japanese food is the attention to detail that goes into the preparation of the food, of the raw materials. And I also think that that same attention to detail is what makes sake as special as it is. It's probably a bit of a stretch that sake and food go together, Japanese food go together, because of the thread of consistency being the attention to detail in the preparation. But personally, I would like to think that that's a big part of it. Moving on from washoku, moving on from Japanese food, pairing sake and Western food, as I mentioned, it's not that difficult. It's not rocket science. It's a lot like pairing wine and food. The principles that you'll use to pair the two of them are actually very, very similar. In short, what you want to do is you want to dovetail or contrast. In other words, you want to find out aspects of the sake and the food that are similar and therefore make each other taste a little bit better, make the food taste a little bit better and the sake taste a little bit better, and therefore make the whole experience better than either one was on its own. So you look for similarities. This could be in flavors, it could be in aromas, it could be in ostentatiousness even, between the food and the sake. The other thing that you can do is to look for contrasts, things that are different, things that make different aspects of the food in sake stand out. A great example is a somewhat salty dish with a somewhat sweet sake. Another would be a somewhat acidic sake with a slightly oily baked fish. Contrasts that bring better aspects of the other product out and make both of them taste better, and the combination of them something yet again in a higher level. Just the other night, we were doing a sake and food pairing dinner. I believe we had five sake paired with five different courses at a restaurant. And one slightly salty preparation of a fish was brought out with a junmai-shu. It's a very simple junmai-shu, a very inexpensive, simple, straightforward junmai-shu that I've probably had 100 times. And while it's good, it was just nothing stood out about it, nothing ostentatious stood out about it. But when we paired it with this other dish, and because of the spices and the saltiness of that dish, flavors that were previously imperceptible in the sake actually came out. I mean, there's really a lot of potential in this kind of thing. You can bring out flavors in a sake that weren't there a minute ago if you can pair properly with something that either has something similar to the sake or something that contrasts it to pull out some of the flavors and aromas that are hidden in there. The next thing I'd like to talk about is what you can't do when pairing sake and food. And I think this is an important part of it as well. Especially when we look at pairing wine and food, there are a number of things that you can count on doing, you can depend on doing, and do it quite often. And I think a lot of these things you can't really do with sake. And one good example is pairing sake based on the region. I think very often, especially with some parts of the world, you can look at the label of the wine and say, well, it's from this particular region, therefore it will taste like this, it'll have this kind of sweetness to it, this kind of acidity, these kinds of aromas, this kind of weight and intensity, and therefore it would go well with something like this kind of a dish. And that works very well, at least with some parts of the world, wine from some parts of the world. However, with sake, you can't really depend on this. You can't really do it that way. There's a number of reasons, but most importantly, if you look at regionality in the sake world, if I can go off on a quick tangent, in other words, does sake have regionality? Does sake from this part of the country tastes like this, where sake from this part of the country tastes like this? And the answer to the question is yes, sake does have regionality to it. However, not every single region of Japan has a regional style sake associated with it. Every part of Japan makes great sake, but not all regions have a consistent style across that particular region. In my mind, I would say 60 to 70% of the regions of Japan do have a consistent style across them. However, the problem arises when if you try to look at a particular region, let's use Niigata Prefecture as an example. Very well known for light, clean, and dry sake. However, I would say 30 to 40% of the breweries in that region won't conform to that style. And you could probably say that about any region. So for any region that has a style that could be associated with it, you're looking at 30 to 40% of the breweries in there that won't conform to that style. And if you're trying to pair based on a region, a 40% chance of error is probably not as accurate to you, as dependable as you would like to be when making a decision on pairing. So you can't really make a decision based on the region from which a sake comes alone. That's not enough information. There's too many exceptions. Very quickly, by the way, the things that affect regionality in sake, there's a lot of them. One of them is temperature. The farther northeast you go, the colder it's going to be. The farther southwest you go, the warmer it's going to be. And there's significant differences in the northern part of Japan and the southwestern part. And just like the difference between lagers and ales, in other words, if you ferment at a colder temperature, you're going to get a much cleaner, tighter flavor profile than if you ferment at a lower temperature, where you get a much rougher, fuller, big-boned flavor profile. So the region, the ambient temperatures contribute to regional style. Other things that might are the guild of the master brewer, because they have different tricks of the trades, the rice that would grow in that particular region, the food that comes from that particular region, and there's other things that will contribute to regionality in sake. So it does have regionality, but it's not going to be as consistent or dependable enough to make a pairing in food based on the regionality alone. The next thing you can't do is make a pairing based on the rice variety. Just like wine, good sake is made from rice that's different from regular table rice. And there's probably about 100 varieties of sake rice out there. If you wanted to study them, there's probably about 10 or 12 that are worth remembering. And they do have flavor profiles that can be associated with them. However, the connection between rice type and the final flavor profile of the sake is not as nearly as tight as a connection between grapes and the final flavor profile in the wine. Another way to express that is two brewers can take in the exact same rice from the same field, milled down to the same degree, and they can make two totally different sake. the way they grow the koji mold down there, the temperature at which they ferment, the yeast they choose to use, how many times and how strongly they pasteurize. Could take these two sake down in a million different paths. So yeah, rices do have a thread of consistency that runs through them, two different brewers can take the same rice and make two totally different sake. So for that reason, it's very difficult to try and make a pairing with food based on the rice variety alone. A third thing that you can't dependably do is to make a pairing based on the grade of sake. For example, a lot of junmai-shu is rich and full with a good acidity. Usually it doesn't have very much of an aroma at all. However, especially lately, with new tricks and new technology, there's a lot of fruity junmai-shu out there as well. So there's exceptions to these rules as well. Daiginjo is another example of sake that's usually very fruity, and you might want to use as an aperitif or to cleanse your palate between courses, but there's a lot of daiginjo out there that isn't as fruity or so ostentatious anymore either. So there's a lot of overlap between the grades. Having said that pairing by grade is not as dependable, if you had to choose one of these, actually, pairing by grade works better than anything else. If you wanted to use one of these things to make a decision, certainly most junmai is going to be fuller and with a good acidity and fewer exceptions than some of the other rules. The same would go for a ginjo or a daiginjo. You'll have many more aromatic things and lesser exceptions to that. So if you wanted to use one of these three rules, this would be a good one that you could use. What you can do is to get to know the sake very, very well. To successfully pair sake with food, you've got to know the sake. The label itself probably won't give you enough information. There's a lot of sake out there. Getting to know them all is a daunting task, but it can be enjoyable. And so I definitely encourage everybody to do your best to do that. But getting to know the sake is really a key to learning how to successfully pair sake with food. More concretely speaking of some aspects that we can do, of some things that we look at to pair. Pairing sake based on the umami content is a good way to do it. Now, I think that a lot of people are comfortable with the term umami, but just to be sure, umami is a flavor that doesn't really have a perfect English translation. I like the term subtle richness. Other people say savoriness or yumminess. Parmesan cheese has a lot of it, mushrooms do, scallops do. Ripe tomatoes versus unripe tomatoes. To me, one of the most enjoyable and easy ways to really sense what umami is to take some green tea and make some green tea with boiling water right off the boil, so as close to boiling temperature as possible. Then make another cup with the same tea and steep it the same amount of time with tepid water, water that's cooled down about 10 or 20 degrees. You'll find much more umami in the tea, the green tea that's been made with tepid water. It's very easy to do, and you'll really see what umami is all about. So umami is a great thing to pair, the level of umami in the sake compared to the level of umami in the food. There are those that say it's all about umami. I don't go that far myself. I think it's a great tool, a very easy one to use, but I don't think it's the only game in town when it comes to pairing. But it is one aspect that you can use quite easily. Another one is acidity. And as I mentioned, sake doesn't have but a tenth to a fifth of the acidity of white wine on the average. However, different sakes have different levels of acidity, and because sake has a lower overall footprint, a more delicate presence, acidity can be prominent in the sake. Even if you don't have the amount of volume or the sheer acidity that you would have with a wine, it's still got enough to work with. So, especially comparatively, if you were to look at a fairly low acid ginjo and have a more acidic junmai-shu, the more acidic junmai-shu might do a great job of pairing well with an oilier fish or even with some grilled meat because that acidity could be used to cut the fat. So acidity is another one I think that works well too. Sweetness is yet another thing that we can grab onto. Now usually we talk about sweetness and dryness together as different aspects of the same flavor. But when talking about pairing food, to me, dryness just refers to an absence of acidity, a lack of sweetness. So I think it's just easier to talk about sweetness. It's very prominent. It comes out at different temperatures more vividly. It's something that's made much more prominent by a bit of saltiness in the food. So I think that this is one aspect that we could focus on to make sake and pairings a little bit more simple. There are a couple other things that we can look at as well. Heaviness and lightness of the sake. So pair heavier sake with heavier food and lighter sake with lighter food. Aromas. Now, most ginjo has very fruity aromas. That might be difficult to pair with a meat dish or something later in the meal. But it might be great as an aperitif or between courses to kind of cleanse your palate and your sense of smell as well. There are sake that have gamier aromas or herbal aromas too that you could use to pair with vegetable dishes and other things like that. Intensity is another one. And when I talk about intensity, that's expressed by alcohol content. I mean, almost all sake's got about 15.5 to 16.5% alcohol. Almost all sake's about 16% alcohol. But if you were to get a genshu or an undiluted sake, very often you can get 17, 18, even 19% alcohol. And that extra 2 or 3% is very big. It makes a big difference. Just the impact or the intensity of the sake with just 2 or 3% more alcohol is much, much larger than regular sake without that higher alcohol content. And a more intense, the way it hits your palate, when that's more intense, or the more intense overall flavor profile, is something that's going to lend itself to bigger, fuller flavors as well in the food. So intensity, I think, is something that you can work with quite a bit as well. Texture, to me, now we're getting into my own little world here, but sake has texture to it as well. Some of it's grainy in texture, some of it has much more richer textures. And I think that pairing a texture of a sake with the flavors in the food is something that I find is very valid and very easy to work with as well. Beyond this, there's dozens and others of other things that you can use to pair sake, et cetera, ad infinitum, and just lots of other things you can do. But I think the main ones really are umami and acidity and sweetness, and some of the other ones, the intensity or the aromas, are things that are quite easy to focus on when pairing with sake. I'd like to move just a little bit from generalities into some specifics and offer four or five things that I think are really easy to put together to experience pairing Western food and sake, and very enjoyable as well. And the first of those is namazake with bitter vegetables. Namazake, as I'm sure you recall, means unpasteurized sake. Name means unpasteurized. And as I'm sure you recall, unpasteurized sake must be kept cold. It needs to be kept refrigerated, or the chances of that going bad, undrinkable, are very high. So you definitely want to keep namazake refrigerated. However, even if you keep track of it, from my experience, once namazake gets about 4 or 5 months old, a bit of a bitterness comes out in the background. And it's not that big. It's not that overpowering. There are those that might ding that as a fault, but I personally like it. I find it much more easy to pair that kind of sake with food than when it doesn't have that bitterness out. So a bit of the bitterness in the background, to me, pairs wonderfully with something like arugula or asparagus. It just ties the two of them together really, really well. Now, the good news is that not so much namazake makes it here to the United States, because it is hard to care for. From the time it leaves at the brewery all the way in the ship, on the trucks to the retailer, it needs to be kept refrigerated. But even if they keep it refrigerated the whole time, by the time it leaves the brewery in Japan and gets shipped over here to your retailer, you are going to have some time pass. It'll probably be 2 months. So there's a good chance that that wonderful bitterness that I like will be apparent. And so I think it's very easy to find that in namazake here in the United States and use that to make a pairing with bitter vegetables. Another thing that I think is extremely easy to put together at home for people is a simple cream-based pasta with bacon on top versus paired with a junmai-shu. To me, the saltiness of the bacon will bring out a really pleasant sweetness with most simple, straightforward junmai-shu. On top of that, the umami that a lot of junmai-shu has will tie in well with the cheese, if it's on there, and the cream and the sauce. And finally, the acidity, the higher than average acidity that a lot of junmai-shu has, will cut through that fat at the end and kind of prepare your palate for the next taste. And this, to me, is really simple to put together at home. And junmai-shu is very readily available and not very expensive at all. So it's kind of a very easy way to get into the world of pairing Western food and sake fairly quickly. Another one is ginjo and oysters. Now, originally I was going to say ginjo and sashimi, and that almost goes without saying, but I was trying to pull away from Japanese food and focus a bit more on Western food. And I think this is something that's very commonly eaten, at least in certain seasons, and a very light, delicate, even fruity ginjo will go extremely well with a wide range of oysters. And this is another very simple mash to put together that can really demonstrate the pairing potential of sake with Western food. Next, sake in general and vinegar dishes. What I really meant to say was fermented things, or pickled things, actually. Japan is a country that basically pickles and ferments just about everything. And they use a lot more than just vinegar to pickle and ferment things in Japan. But here, there's a lot of pickled food and a lot of fermented food here as well. And I know of no better way to make a whole bottle of sake disappear very, very quickly than to sit down with some pickled things or some fermented things and just nibble at them. Then it just invites more and more sake. To me, it's just a really easy way to enjoy sake very, very quickly, even a bit dangerously from time to time. Next, and quite just as interestingly, before I wrap it up for the presentation tonight, koshu and cheese. Koshu is aged sake. And that kind of works with cheese extremely well. It can be really, really interesting to pair koshu and cheese, much more so than regular sake. Just a word about koshu, there's a little bit to say about it. Number one, unfortunately, very little is made. I mean, like 0.00001% of all sake is matured a long period of time. So really, there's very little koshu out there. Sakaya, the sake dealer in the East Village, I was there yesterday, I think they had one aged sake. So there's not that much out there. There's not that much in Japan either. Very few brewers actually make a good amount of aged sake. On top of that, they've only been experimenting with it for a number of reasons for about 50 to 60 years. And the way they make it is all over the map. They'll start with daiginjo sometimes, they'll start with junmai sometimes. And of course, the differences are gonna be huge. Sometimes they'll do it for 3 years, sometimes for 10. Sometimes in bottles, sometimes in tanks. And the results are all over the map. So it's hard to say aged sake tastes like this. But in general, it's gonna age along the lines of a sherry. It's gonna get richer, earthier. The sharpness will definitely become more prominent. And as such, it pairs very well with cheese. Now, personally, I would prefer drier, sharper cheeses because other types of cheeses tend to coat your tongue a bit too much for sake, in my opinion. But without a doubt, it lends itself to a lot of experimentation. If you work really hard, you could probably find about 10 aged sake in the United States. That's the limit for now. Hopefully that will improve. And I highly encourage experimentation with aged sake and cheese. That can be a really fun thing to do. So before I introduce the brewers, I just wanted to wrap up what I said tonight. To begin, sake and food pairing is not rocket science. It's actually fairly simple. If you know how to pair wine and food, you'll know how to pair sake and food relatively easily. Historically, pairing sake and food is not nearly as active a process in Japan. Pairing sake and food in Japan is not nearly as active a process as pairing wine and food has been in countries outside of Japan. It can be done with great precision and fun. It has a lot of potential to do that. And finally, because there is no one traditional, no one authentic way to do it, I want to encourage everybody to violate authenticity and get out and experiment and just experiment with Western food and all kinds of things and see what you can do. Because knowing the sake and knowing the food well are really the ways that you can open up to experimentation and learn a lot about pairing sake and food overall. So hopefully that's enough information to make you dangerous to yourself and enjoy pairing. We have 30-odd sake out there tonight, but we don't have any food, so you're going to have to be content with just tasting the sake that are out there. If the brewers would please step onto the stage, I'd like to introduce them.
One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine, 10.
So tonight we have 11 brewers. We have 11 brewers from all across Japan. And I'm going to introduce them from the northeastern part of Japan to the southwestern part of Japan in that order. This is also the order by which, according to which the tables are laid out, if that helps you. So from the northernmost island of Hokkaido, making the sake called Takasago and the sake called Ginga Shizuku is Mr. Sato. Representing Nambu Bijin from Iwate Prefecture, we have Ms. Nikawa. Representing the sake called Yamato Shizuku from Akita Prefecture, we have Ms. Sasaki. From Niigata Prefecture, representing the sake Kirin and Kambara, we have Mr. Sato. From Fukushima Prefecture, representing Okunomatsu Sake, we have Mr. Yusa. From Tochigi Prefecture, representing the sake Tentaka, we have Mr. Ozaki. From Okayama Prefecture, representing the sake Chikurin, we have Mr. Marumoto. From Hiroshima Prefecture, representing the sake Fukucho, we have Ms. Imada. From Shimane Prefecture, representing the sake Rihaku, we have Mr. Tanaka. From Yamaguchi Prefecture, representing the sake Dasai, we have Ms. Saito. And from Saga Prefecture, representing the sake Shida and the sake Tenzan, we have Mr. Shida. Every year I mess one up. Can we have another round of applause for the brewers while they go prepare for us? I believe we have three sake from each brewer tonight. There might be some with two and there might be some with four, but I think the average is three. Before we break off to that, for about 10 minutes or so, I'd like to open the floor up to any questions you might have. It could be about sake or food. It could be about anything at all related to sake. I'd be happy to answer them if you had any. We should have at least one or two because they need time to prepare. Ma'am? Pardon me, please? With the shiso-flavored sakes, what are you eating? I'll be honest. Shiso-flavored sake actually isn't legally sake anymore in Japan. Once you flavor it with after pressing and once you add to that, it doesn't really legally classify as sake anymore. The second honest answer I have to say is that I don't drink flavored sakes myself. But in a more helpful vein, as I imagine what it might taste like, I would think that something glazed in miso, maybe a fish with a salty or tart miso that had been baked in that, that seems to me to lend itself very well to something like a shiso-flavored sake. But that was a gut reaction, and I have to experiment a bit more before giving you a better answer on that, though. Is there anyone else? Sir? Ah, right. If you use a lacquered box, what's the right way to do it? Yeah. Let me preface it by saying usually, at least traditionally, when they do pour it in either a lacquered box or a cedar box or wooden box, they like to overflow that, right? So they overflow that in the dish. It's a traditional way of showing that not only are they not skimping, they're giving you more than you paid for. And the answer to your question is there is no proper way. Some people will pick that up and drink the glass and then pour the dish in there. Others will drink right from the dish. There is actually no one proper way to do that. Most people will tend to drink from the corner of the box, but that's probably fairly obvious to do that. So the best answer to the question is there is really no one official proper way to do that, whatever works.
Today I got a small bottle of draft sake, Hakutsuru, from Kobe.
Right.
I know nothing about it, and I've never bought a draft sake before. Could you help?
Sure. Draft sake is basically nama sake, unpasteurized sake. So the word nama in Japanese means a lot of things, but one of the things it means is that nothing's been done to it. So fish, raw fish, is nama sakana, right? And so when they talk about nama sake, what they mean is it hasn't been processed in any way. We would say unpasteurized. So what that really means is unpasteurized sake. However, I can also say this. There are some brewers, and I know that Hakutsuru is one of them, where they've learned to filter using some advanced technology, and then they don't have to use heat to pasteurize the sake. It's been filtered in a special way that removes all of the things that could cause havoc if they didn't heat it. So I know, at least with that particular product, that it's been filtered in a special way so they did not have to heat it. But basically what they're saying is we didn't heat it, and therefore it's nama, it's unpasteurized. But they did special filter to prevent any damage.
Could you talk a little about distribution in the U.S., and where are some good places in New York to buy it?
How much time do you have distribution in the United States? The United States has what's known as a three-tiered system, and that means there's three tiers. The top tier is either the producer or the importer. And they can only sell to distributors. A distributor is the middle tier, and they can only sell to restaurants or retailers. So a distributor cannot sell to us. On top of that, when you import to the United States, you must, let's say I import to California, if I want to sell in New York, I must send it to New York and pass through a distributor in the state of New York. And there are exceptions to this, but it's a very rigid system. And each one of those margins will take, each one of those tiers will take their own margin. So what that means is there's sake that might be available in New York that I can't buy in Ohio. And the reason is that if the distributor in Ohio, because distributors can only sell lots of sake, they can't sell retail, they can't sell one bottle at a time. So if they're not gonna move tons of it, they're not gonna handle it. So that's why if there isn't a distributor in my state that decides to handle a sake, I can't get it. You can ship across state lines sometimes, other times you can't. It'll vary from state to state, it'll vary from place to place. So that's what the three-tiered system is all about in the United States. There's the limitations of it. In terms of where to buy it in New York, obviously Sakaya is one place. Union Square Wines is another. I come to New York twice a year, so they're not fresh on my mind. But there's a list of them in the magazine Chapsticks, for example, and a little poking around will definitely let you know where else to buy it. Astor Wine and Spirits has a nice selection as well. And there's definitely many others as well. So it's worth poking around, but those are the top three that came to my mind. Does that answer your question about the three-tiered system that you were concerned about? Does that cover that? Enough? Okay. We could talk for hours about that. Go ahead, sir.
I've heard that sake has less adverse effects, such as on people, such as a hangover. What are your thoughts on that compared to other alcoholic beverages?
I can guarantee you sake will give you a hangover if you drink enough of it. Having said that, it does seem to be lighter on most people's bodies, or at least they say so. But I think that will vary from person to person. And without a doubt, the best way to not get a hangover is to drink in moderation. But I bet you knew that. Yeah, I would do it more on texture because, nigori is a category by texture. However, there's sweet nigori, there's tart nigori, so you could probably take it beyond that as well. But I think more than anything, the overwhelming aspect of a nigori is going to be its texture. A lot of it is sweet, but not all of it. So the answer to the question is yes. I could have saved a breath there by saying that. Sir?
With Western wines, there's always some sort of emphasis on a particular vintage, say a particular year where the harvest is better. Is there something similar for sake?
Not really. Rice does vary from year to year. You get variations in the crop from year to year. You have good years and bad years in growing rice. However, once you get the raw materials into the brewery, they mill it, they soak it, they steam it, they grow mold on part of it, they control the temperatures and things like that. So the goal of a sake brewer from year to year is consistency. In other words, I think with wine, they roll with it. The good years, they make a wine like this, and the less good years, they make a different kind of wine. But in the sake world, they're trying to eliminate those differences, much the way a champagne house might do that. So really, while there are variations from year to year, if in wine they go like this, in sake they go like this, you will see differences from year to year, but they're minimal. And on the contrary, the brewer is trying to eliminate those. Now, once in a while, you'll see the word vintage on a bottle of aged sake, but it's got no legal meaning whatsoever. I think they're just trying to point out the fact that it's aged when they do that. So,
since you're talking about pairing sake with non-Japanese foods, are there any kind of efforts by distributors to sell to non-Japanese restaurants?
Absolutely, yeah, they're working at it. I mean, the distributors would love to do that. It's the restaurants themselves that don't think that they could work it in with their food. It's changing, but there are a lot of distributors are working on Western restaurants, and it's either the chef or the management that says, look, I don't know where I'd fit this in, you know? And if you can show them, then they start to open up to that. Charlie Trotter recently passed away, and in his restaurant in Chicago, it wasn't him, but it was someone under him, and they were, I don't recall the details, but I believe he had a number of sommeliers that were working for him, that he had them each prepare a dish with a wine maybe once a week, and it was kind of a competition. Whoever won that got to highlight something or something like that. And one person presented a sake, and it's here tonight. It is Fukucho, Moon on the Water. And this sommelier presented that to whoever was in charge at Charlie Trotter's restaurant, and that was the best pairing of the night. After that, that person, the whoever made the decision, incorporated that sake into the list, and after that, Charlie Trotter started to incorporate a lot of sake into his list in Chicago. So things like that do happen, and we need to have them happen more and more as time goes on. There was someone back there who was actively... Go ahead, sir.
Are there heirloom rices? Are they hybridized? Are rices back from hundreds of years?
Oh.
Are they still available?
So the basic answer to the question is yes. There are rices that have gone out of production that were very popular 50, 60 years ago. Why do they go out of production? Maybe they're too hard to harvest. Really, really tall, just difficult to grow, and so rice farmers would move away from them. A couple have been revived, and with great success. There's two or three examples of sake that have been revived with great success. And this is your lucky night, because there's one here tonight. I do not have a business relationship with Fukucho, but it happens to be the same brewery, Fukucho. She's got a sake called Forgotten Fortune, and it's made using a rice called Hattanso, which was revived. In fact, she's the only brewer in Japan that uses that rice. And it had been revived from a seed bank somewhere, and they brought that back. So those things do exist, and you can taste one tonight. Is anybody else? Sir, next to him.
Hey, John, there used to be, or I used to hear of a sort of conventional wisdom that you don't pair sake with sushi because of rice-on-rice mm-hmm. component. And I've seen chefs scold patrons who tried to order sake. But that certainly has changed.
Sure.
What are your thoughts on that in general?
Where that really came from is the old days when men would drink sake. They would sit there, they would have nibbles with the sake. They would just eat fish or eat this or that, little things. And the way a traditional Japanese meal works is once you've eaten all the smaller dishes, you're done with that, and they take the sake off the table too, and then they bring out the rice and the miso soup and the pickles. And I think that thinking came from that. There's no reason you can't pair rice with sake if it works well. And you can pair sushi with it as well. But the reason that many people shun from it is not because it doesn't go well together, but because traditionally that wasn't done, and that became a kind of a practice. That thinking is remarkably deeply ingrained in some people's minds, although there really isn't a good technical reason for it.
Can you talk about price points?
Price points.
From Table 8. As being rare and interesting sake, so what do these cost? You know, I'm always confused when I go to a liquor store. This lady and I were discussing how do we buy sake, and she says price.
Well, price will work. Here, let me say a couple things that might be useful. Price will work. 90% of the time, sake is fairly priced. 90% of the time, you're going to get what you pay for, right? So the more expensive ones are going to be more aromatic and lighter. However, once you know your own preferences, that formula doesn't work anymore. If you know you want a sweet one or a full one or a richer one, then that price thing alone isn't going to work. But if you want to go with the simplest way to do it, if you make a decision based on price, if one is 20, another one's 60, almost all the time are going to say the $60 sake is better. Exceptions, yeah, maybe 10% of the time. And then personal preferences come in. Now, once it gives up about, this is off the top of my head, above 120 or so, then the law of diminishing returns kicks in. And I don't... No, I think they just don't know what the retail prices are off the top of their head. You might want to suggest to the Japan Society that they include retail prices next year. But certainly the brewers aren't hiding it. I think they just don't know. They know what they sold it to the exporter for, and that's about it. In terms of other things that affect price, for example, that Hattanso is only a junmai. But she had to, that rice is really expensive because she's the only one that gets it. It's not mass produced. So that kind of artificially drives that price up. So that might be an exception where the price is, well, let's just say there's exceptions to the price and quality thing there. So. But basically, you get what you pay for with a lot of exceptions. That's talking too much there. I should have quit while I was behind.
Talking about tradition, is there any way that you drink sake in a tradition way? Let's say you drink wine, so you put two glasses together, say chin chin, and you keep drinking. Is there any tradition in Japanese sake drinking?
Yeah, there's very few, but there are some. Basically, one tradition is you don't want to pour for yourself. You pour the other person's glass, they pour for you. And generally, you hold the glass in the air when that pouring is taking place. And then everybody kind of waits for the first drink, And then instead of cheers, you say kanpai. So that's probably the simplest way to convey it. But the one rule I think you want to remember is you don't pour your own drink. And even that rule breaks down throughout the evening. Fairly quickly in some circles. I think the brewers might be ready for us, so if there's no more questions, we can. Folks, thanks very much. I'll be floating around if there's any more questions.